meet you. Well, my name's Johnny, but most people call me Biggin.
Man, I tell you, there's one thing I don't like more than crowded rooms, it's bad football calls.
Hi, how are you? Hi, how are you doing tonight? Oh, I'm blessed and highly favored. Thank you for asking. Obviously, I'm a Dallas Cowboys fan, okay? And it was a catch, all right? I believe with everyone in America, I believe it's a conspiracy. Abraham Lincoln, JFK, the moon landing, Tupac, and now Dez Bryant. He caught the football, America.
How many cats is too many cats?
Yeah, girl. You ever been in a Corvette before? I bet that'd be cool.
You ever seen the backseat of an 85 Camaro? I got a thing for fingernails.
What are your top five all-time favorite movies? Let me just tell you mine first. Number one, Die Hard 1. Number two, Die Hard 2. Number three, Jaws 3. Number four, Die Hard 4. And then number five has to be Titanic. They're out there on the frozen water and she's like, I'll never let go, Jeff. And then she freaking lets him go. Are you kidding me? That's just like a woman thing to do. She's like, I'll never let you go. And then she lets him go.
Yeah, I'm at the office for a little bit longer tonight. And then, yeah, I've got a work thing in the morning. And then, yeah, cool. Okay, all right, love you, bye. Where were we, girl?
As I was praying for our time together this morning at 4 a.m. at my third prayer session for the day, I wrote down my Moleskine journal, just something that really spoke to me, and I wanted to read it to you.
Yeah, the internet's in my place ain't so good. I borrow from the neighbor so the government can't keep their tabs on me. I'd stay off grid, keep a low profile. You ever skin a cat?
Dez Bryant is an athletic specimen of speed and aerodynamics. All he does is win. All he does is catch the football. Okay, you tell me, you show me one American who says that he didn't catch that football and I will show you a terrorist.
So enough about me. Let's talk about Dale Earnhardt Jr. Best NASCAR racer in the history of NASCAR racing. Now, sure, you might think he hasn't won that many races, and he really hasn't, but that man drives with his whole heart.
You know the leading cause of heart attacks in Texas? Tony Romo.
Anyway.
And Cole Beasley, he's like the little weasel wonder from the southeast. All right, that boy's running all over the field. He's about one big hit away from getting cracked in half. But I'll tell you what, that boy can catch the football and he can run. Run for it! Run, Cole Beasley! I'll tell you what. You know what I got under this shirt? Another Dallas Cowboys t-shirt. You know what I got under these britches, lady? Check this out. You're gonna like this. Now, of course, I'll sing a hymn because contemporary music is shallow and soulless and straight from the bowels of Satan himself, but another conversation for another time. I will call upon the...
Couldn't help but notice you walking in tonight, so if you forget where you parked, you just come find me.
The following sermon is rated PG due to mature subject matter.
Thank you. Well, I want to welcome those of you watching at church online or at one of our campuses or on TV. We are pumped that you're joining us right now as well. And we are finishing up a series today called Bad Dating. And if you missed any of the first three parts to that series, you can check it online. Our website is experiencelifenow.com. You can go there and catch up on this series or any of our other series. For that matter. And today, as we wrap up this series, we are going to be interviewing some godly couples that we've brought in to talk with you today and answer some questions about their relationships. And so here's the thing. If you're dating or if you ever hope to be married one day, you want what these guys have. And so you want to listen and pay attention to what they have to say. In fact, Solomon, who is considered one of the wisest men to ever live, said this in Proverbs chapter 1. Check this out. He said, "My child, listen when your father corrects you. Don't neglect your mother's instruction. What you learn from them will crown you with grace and be a chain of honor around your neck." And so Solomon says, listen, if you want to be crowned with honor and grace and to receive that the reward that he's talking about, he says you need to listen when people who are more experienced than you instruct you and teach you on some things. You need to allow yourself to be corrected even about some things that aren't going well in your life or that you're not doing according to God's plan. And so we're going to bring out some couples here in just a second, and they've got some incredible things to tell you. And so if you're dating or if you want to be married, or even for those of you that are married, you probably are going to learn a lot from these couples because they've been married a long time, over 30 years, and they've got a lot to share with us today. So we are very excited that you're going to get to hear from them. So first, would you help me welcome the Laveaux? This is Greg and Wendy Laveaux. Greg is our pastoral care pastor, has been with us since the beginning, since the church started, and then eventually came on staff as one of our pastors. And so Greg is our pastoral care pastor. Wendy does designer walls and furniture for a local studio here in town. They have two kids and three grandkids and have been married for 32 years. Let's just thank them for being here. Thank you guys for being here today with us. Next, we have the Gilliams. Would you guys help me welcome the Gilliams? This is Dr. Charlie Gilliam. He's a periodontist here in Lubbock. And Tanya Gilliam is a part of a ministry here in town called Isaiah 58. They work in the prison, and she helps try to rescue girls from sex trafficking here in town. And so we are honored to have them here with us as well. They have three kids and six grandkids, and they have been married for 38 years. So thank you guys for being here as well. So let's get started with question number one. You can see it with me right here on the screen. Many singles think the key to happiness is getting married. Did you ever think that? And what did you find out once you got married? Wendy?
I remember as a young girl daydreaming about my future. I would find Mr. Right. We would fall in love, get married, live happily ever after. The last week of my first semester in college, Mr. Wright winked at me, and we fell in love, and like 3.5 years later, we got married. The day we got home from our honeymoon, I was moving my stuff from my apartment into his apartment, and he made the terrible mistake of making a comment about the excessive amount of belts that I owned, so there went our happily ever after. Whether single or married, I think we all need to be careful. We have to be careful about thinking marriage or a spouse can meet needs that really only Jesus can meet. Greg, I love being married to this guy, but he can't fix me. And I remember hearing Chris speak the very first message, and he said, if we aren't happy single, we won't be happy married either.
That's good, Wendy. You know, one of the things Chris said in the first part of the series is that spouses make bad saviors. And so whether you're single or married, that's some good information. That's good to remember that Jesus is the only one that can fulfill all the areas of our life that need to be filled in. And is the only one that can really, that can fix us and change us and bring healing in our lives. So that's good. All right, question number two. What are some things singles should focus on in preparation for marriage? Charlie, Tanya?
Yes, thank you very much. The first thing I want to mention is that if you're single, you know, God does have somebody very special for you. And Tanya and I both believe in divine intervention, and that just don't get in a hurry. And when you do meet somebody, realize there's just no coincidences. It is a divine intervention. As for me, in 1975, I was going into my senior year at Texas Tech. I was in a fraternity, having a lot of fun with my fraternity brothers, and the last thing I was thinking about was marriage. I met Tanya, started dating her in 75. We're married in 76. And that was not my plan. That was not my time schedule. That was all God. And looking back, that was God in our lives, and his plan is perfect. The second thing I can say is, you know, as corny as this sounds for the kids out there, you really do need to pick good friends. And Clayton already mentioned Solomon. Solomon also said, walk with the wise and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm. And, you know, what that is, I reflect my life, when I made my best choices in my life, I was around good, godly people getting good, godly counsel. When I tend to make poor choices, I was around people who were, you know, following the world, and it, like Solomon says, you'll suffer harm if you do that. Mm-hmm. We mentioned a little bit, you know, you really need to focus on God, because, you know, Wendy already talked a little bit about this, but when I look back and I found myself, you know, focusing on myself and my needs and my desires, the last thing, I forgot about God there, and I got bitter, and I got hurt, and I got, you know, upset for crazy reasons. But when you do become focused on God, you receive the blessings. You need to realize that marriage does not mean joy and happiness. There is a lot of joy and happiness in marriage, but there's a lot of other emotions involved too. What marriage is marriage is a covenant that we make before God, and it's a lifetime commitment to love Him, love your wife, in riches and poor, in sickness and health, till death do you part. So kind of just to summarize a little bit, follow Jesus, pick good friends, and don't live in the world. You want to say anything?
I got a couple of things. I have two things to add to that, and one of them is don't marry a selfish person. Marriage is about giving more than it is taking. And if you and your spouse are willing to both give more than you are taking, then you will have a very blessed marriage. And the second thing I want to talk about is there is a book out called The Five Languages of Love, and it's by Gary Chapman. Last night I said Gary Smalley, but it's Gary Chapman. It is a must read for anybody who wants to get married. We all have a love language, and it is very wise for us to know what our spouse's or our intended spouse's love language is. For me, mine is doing something nice for me, like bringing me a cup of coffee in the morning or before I get out of bed, or maybe unloading the dishwasher for me. That is the thing. There's where my love language is. For my husband, well, intimacy is his love language. So when you know, I mean, it could be gifts, whatever it is, meet that person's love language. It will make your life so much more precious.
That's good. Charlie, just keep unloading that dishwasher, man. Sounds like you'll be all right. Okay, question number three. How have you seen premarital sex hurt people?
Greg?
Good morning. You know, I talk to couples all the time, and they all seem to be having trouble, the ones that come in to visit. And there's a common theme that runs between them all, and they are having premarital sex or have had sex before a marriage. You know, and their stories often go like this. My wife is having an affair, and I just don't understand why she's doing this to me. Or they go like this. My husband is going to divorce me. He says he doesn't love me anymore, and he just can't stand to see my face. Or they'll come in and say, man, they've changed. This is not the person who I thought I was marrying. What happened? You know, there's some statistics I'd like to share with you about couples who engage in premarital sex. Couples who are actively engaging in sex before marriage are 3.3 times more likely to experience the pain of an affair. Couples who are having premarital sex have a 50 to 80% higher divorce rate compared to those who wait. 50 to 80% higher. There's a higher rate of domestic violence. Sex before marriage negatively affects male commitment to relationships. Let's stop for a minute and think about that. Let's say a couple's together, they get pregnant. Statistics show that within 2 years, the male's gone. He's no longer in the picture. So what's left? A single mom and a fatherless child. Sex before marriage is known to be a barrier in developing communication skills. You know, what this says to me is that couples don't care about working out their problems. They just want to go do the making up thing because they enjoy that more than trying to fix themselves. You know, and that ends up coming back to bite them. You know, what I've discovered over the years of visiting with people is that couples have to learn how to resolve conflict if they expect their relationships to survive. You know, we've been talking about men and women, couples, but what about the children? Children of parents who are living together are 20 times more likely to be subject to child abuse. Children living with their biological mother and a live-in boyfriend are 33 times more likely to be abused. That's high. That's almost a guarantee that somebody's going to get abused. On average, 75% of children born to cohabiting parents will see them split up before that child reaches 16. So, you know, you're asking me, how have I seen premarital sex hurt people, affairs, divorce, abuse, and abandonment? You know, couples, people that are thinking about being in relationships, let me encourage you, put the lid back on the marriage box. Don't be a statistic. Please do not be a statistic.
That's good, Greg. You know, as our care pastor, Greg meets with people constantly meeting with couples who are struggling, with singles who are struggling. And so definitely want to encourage you to listen to that advice and to the statistics that he was talking about. That's some good information. Thanks, Greg. Question number four. How do you allow God to heal the scars of sexual sin? Charlie, Tanya?
Thank you. This is a tough one. And you know, when Chris asked Tanya me to be part of this, I fully understood why he wanted the LaVeaux and Tanya, but I felt like I was the most unworthy person to be up here talking. And when Chris said, well, I could impart some wisdom, and I didn't really understand that either, but when I started looking at, you know, where does wisdom come from? And wisdom comes from good judgment. And it's unfortunate, but good judgment comes from experience. And it's even more unfortunate that experience comes from bad judgment. And so I have a lot of experience. And the band reminds us, you know, multiple times that God never fails, he never gives up, he never runs out on me. Which means we do have a God of second chances. And I feel like Tanya, working with Isaiah 58, which is a prison ministry here in town, she works with ladies every day that need a second chance. And so I'm going to let her follow this up a little bit.
Okay, thank you. If you are living in sexual sin, I just wanted to let you know you are not alone. King David, a man after God's own heart, wrestled with sexual sin. God knew this was going to be a huge problem for us. So we are not alone. Anyway, when I was thinking about this, there are many ways or many reasons why we fall into sexual sin, but too often they are because we do not know God's truth. I work with the ladies in the jail weekly, and we talk about this week after week. Where does your truth come from? Does your truth come from God, or does it come from the world? Folks, that is too opposite. We have got to know what God's truth is for us to be able to walk in freedom. We do have a choice, and we either make that choice to believe God's word or we will believe the lies of Satan. John 8:31 says it perfectly. It says, if you abide in my word, you are my disciple. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. If you want to heal from sexual sin, the very first and foremost thing that you have to do is you must know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. There is no other way. We cannot change ourselves. We cannot change anybody else. Only God can change us. The second is we must recognize the truth about sexual sin, about sin, period. You got to know, folks, that you know God's truth. And the third is you need to break the bonds of sin. You've got to cut it off. You got to repent, and you got to turn from that sin. God promises us in his word that if we are obedient and will repent and turn from that sin, he will forgive us and he will heal us and restore us like we have, our minds can't even conceive what he will do with that. And the fourth one is you're going to have to fight the battle daily. Every day, the Lord is our strength. He will help us. He promises us in his word. When we call, he answers. When we cry out for help, he says, here am I. We've got to seek him every day. The world is so loud. There's so many distractions out there. There's TVs and video and internet. There's Facebook and Twitter and Snapchat and everything else you can ever dream of. It is total chaos. If we don't take daily time to sit with the Lord and listen to his voice, he has a whole lot to talk to us about. Every day, listen, be still, and know what God has to say to us. And then we need to pray every day. Pray and give him thanks, for he's doing something here. He's doing something big in us. So thank him every day for what we have for today. And then stand firm against all temptation. You're going to have to stand firm, folks. You're going to have to stand firm. When it comes rolling at you, you're going to have to stay firm in the word of God. You're going to have to confess your sin. God tells us in his word that if you will confess your sin out loud to a brother or sister in Christ, once that is spoken out, it loses its power over us. So speak it out. And then you need to surround yourself with like-minded people, Christians. Don't go to those places and around those people that trigger that kind of behavior, run like the wind. You cannot go there. And then, I think that's it.
Okay, that's good.
That's the end. Good stuff.
Thank you very much. God. Okay, so for this next question, we've talked some over the last few weeks in this series as about something that Chris would call like getting it on like Donkey Kong. He also has this phrase, getting jiggy with it in the bedroom, okay? I don't know where he comes up with this stuff, but so we've been talking about that over the last few weeks. Now, as we have, Brandon, our worship pastor here, Lee, our downtown campus pastor, have had a question about this because they're getting older, okay? And a lot older than me, I promise you. But as they're getting older, they're wanting to know this next question, okay? So question number five, when you get older, does it still work? So, thank you, Brandon and Lee.
Well,
does it still work? Does it change as you get older?
Tanya, you want to answer this?
No.
Where is Brandon? I was afraid this question was going to come up, and so were my kids. And my kids said they weren't going to be coming to this service today. So, and I don't see them out there, but I want to talk to them a little bit if I can. And this will help Brandon with his question.
Sure.
Kids, when come home and you see mom and dad's car both in the garage, all right, and then the come in the back door, and the security's on. And if you look down the hallway and the bedroom door is closed, that means don't come in. All right? And I'm not saying this for Tanya's and my protection. I'm saying that for yours, and that's and the reason why is the first week of this series, Chris mentioned that if you walk in on your parents, you'd be scarred for life. I don't want that happening to y'all, okay?
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Wendy?
Clayton, you know I have to say this. It worked last night. Okay, but you asked if it changes, and I would have to say that it does. Greg and I probably appreciate sex more than we did when we were younger, and here's why. I think all couples, you know, as us, have barriers or what would you call them? Just challenges to intimacy. Greg and I had hip surgery because I fell and broke my hip. I had a detached retina, had surgery, and the recovery for the required recovery is that you lie, you know, face down for 22 hours a day. Well, that is not conducive to intimacy at all. And I had, you know, started having hot flashes. And our son passed away, and 2 months after he passed away, we lost my dad. A week right before Christmas, Greg had a heart attack, and he knows that we had to ask the doctor if it was the activity that we had earlier that morning that had caused the heart attack, and it wasn't. It was not. Since we're on the subject, yeah, I'm sorry. Did I mention hot flashes?
Yeah, I'm having one.
Okay. Anyway, these could disconnect us, but God has actually used them to draw us closer to Him and closer to each other. And that just makes for better sex.
That's good. That's good. I think we're all shocked and greatly encouraged by that. Yes. Thank you. Thank you for being so descriptive. Okay. Question number six. Why do you think dating an unbeliever is so dangerous? Greg?
I don't know if I can do this. Well, Clayton, it's kind of like this. You're in a car and you're headed to Las Vegas, and I have this idea that I want to go to Disney World, so, you know, I stop you and I get in your car, and I have expectations that I'm going to end up in Disney World. But where do you think I end up? Las Vegas. Not where I wanted to go. So let me give you an example. Let's say there's a woman who calls my office, and she's really upset because her live-in boyfriend is abusing her and her children. He is abusing alcohol and drugs. You know, so I ask her, is your boyfriend a Christian? And she says, no. I ask her, how's your relationship with Jesus? She says, well, now that you ask, I haven't been to church or even prayed since I started seeing this man and he moved into my house. You know, she ended up going the wrong way. So it's kind of like this. Let's think about this a minute. This woman had very good intentions of getting on a road towards the light. But she stopped somewhere along the way and got in the car of somebody that was headed to darkness. And she found out that she was in the wrong place. You know, it's dangerous. We all think that, as far as we, people that are Christ followers, really believe that we can save somebody that is not a Christian when we enter into a relationship with them. But, you know, one day we wake up and figure out that we're the ones that need to be saved. So please be careful.
That's good. Thank you, Greg. Question number seven, last question. Some people probably think they've made so many mistakes in dating, they're not even sure if God can forgive them. What would you say to them? Greg, you want to take that one again?
Yeah. You know, they don't deserve to be forgiven, but you know, neither do I. I took my very first date to see the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. You know, do I deserve to be forgiven for that? No, I don't, because that girl probably was scarred for life, because I know I was. And you know, I could have carried that burden around with me my entire life, but you know, when I was younger, I committed my life to Jesus, and I confessed my sin, and I was made right with God. You know, Jesus died on the cross 2,000 years ago, and he was buried in a tomb, and he was there for 3 days, and he was raised to life again. You know, and he went through all that for you, so you could be made right with God. He did that so every person here has an opportunity to have their wrong list wiped clean. So if you're here today and you are feeling the weight of all the things you've done wrong in your life just pressing down on you, come to Jesus. Jesus is the one that's able to forgive you. You know, it's like this. Admit you're wrong. Admit that you've done many things wrong. You've done dating wrong. And ask Jesus to forgive you. Then commit your life to following him the rest of your days. You know, Brandon said something like this last week. Don't let your past define your future. Let Jesus be your future.
Thanks, Greg. And some of you are here today, you've never committed your life to Jesus before. And we believe that's why you're here, was to hear what Greg was just saying, that you can come to Jesus. Your sin, past, present, and future can be forgiven. You can be made right with God, and you can know for sure that when you die, you're going to heaven. If you'll commit your life to Jesus, trust in his payment of your fine through his death on the cross, you could be saved. Your sin could be forgiven. And so if that's you, I want to challenge you. Take out the connection card that was in your chair. Fill it out. Check the box that says, I'm committing my life to Christ today. Then take it to our Next Step Center. It's in the middle of our foyer. We've got a free gift for you to help you in your new relationship with Jesus. We've got a team there that wants to pray with you and just kind of point you in the right direction now that you've committed your life to Christ. And so if that's you, make sure to fill out that card and stop by the Next Step Center on your way out. But you know, one of the things we've been saying throughout this series is that you have a choice to make. You can either listen to what the world has to say, your friends, TV, movies. You can listen to what our culture has to say about relationships and sex. Or you can listen to what God has to say in his word. You can listen to what God has had to say through the couples today that we've had with us. And listen, we want to challenge you with this. If you'll listen to what God has to say, if you'll do things his way, you can experience God's best in your life. And it's not too late. Regardless of what you've done in your past or regardless of what you're even doing right now in your present, God can forgive you of that sin. He can begin to heal you. And if you begin to do things God's way, you can experience God's best. And so we want to challenge you with that. Listen to God. Don't listen to this world. Don't listen to the culture. Listen to what God has to say, and you'll experience his best. Let's thank our couples again for sharing with us today. Thank you, guys. We'd like to pray and just wrap up this series and just ask God to help us live out the things that we've been talking about. God, we thank you for this whole series and everything that you've been telling us. And God, I pray that you would help us to live out the things that we've talked about. God, knowing that it's never too late to experience your best. So God, I pray that you'd help us to know your word, to know your truth, and to live it out and to do what it says, to do relationships, to do dating, to do marriage, to do sex your way, the way that you designed it, knowing that if we do that, we'll experience your best. So God, thank you for every person that's here today at all of our campuses. God, I pray that you'd bless them today with the words that they've heard. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thanks for checking out one of our messages today. For more information about our church or to watch other messages, you can go to our website at experiencelifenow.com. Let us know if we can serve you in any way, and we hope to see you real soon.